Well, because of those puzzled looks I get from students, and I'm seeing a few here now, it's not much longer. I decided to develop my own approach, and I call it simply Tillman's Overly Simplified Approach. I begin with the Bible. Surprise. Now I'm going to get assistance. This becomes audience participation. Ross, where did you go? There he is. Okay. Does everything need to be heard from this microphone? Okay. Ross West, and he and I have known each other a long time, and we are sort of comrades in arms on a lot of things about Baptist Way Press. But he's going to read the first passage. It is Leviticus chapter 19, verses 1 and 2, and then verses 9 through 18. And just a minute, Ross. And in a moment, Van, you're closer. There's Stacy up there, but you're closer. Here's another one of those ethics people that live in this state. I would like for you to read something from Matthew. You may. Do you have anything about the revised standard? New revised? Okay.
Okay, listen to Dr. West.
This is Leviticus 19, 1 and 2.
1 and 2, and then 9 through 18.
All right. This is New American Standard.
I don't think it's on, Ross. Who has the buttons to control the sound?
How about now? Now?
Yeah.
Okay, that's good. All right. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "Speak to all the congregation of the sons of Israel, and say to them, 'You shall be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy.'"
And then verses 9 through 18.
All right. "Now when you reap the harvest of your land, you shall not reap to the very corners of your field, nor shall you gather the gleanings of your harvest, nor shall you glean your vineyard, nor shall you gather the fallen fruit of your vineyard. You shall leave them for the needy and for the stranger. I am the Lord your God. You shall not steal, nor deal falsely, nor lie to one another. You shall not swear falsely by my name, so as to profane the name of the Lord your God. Name of your God. I am the Lord. You shall not oppress your neighbor, nor rob him. The wages of a hired man are not to remain with you all night until morning. You shall not curse a deaf man, nor place a stumbling block before the blind. But you shall revere your God. I am the Lord. You shall do no injustice in judgment. You shall not be partial to the poor, nor defer to the great, but you are to judge your neighbor fairly. You shall not go about as a slanderer among your people, and you are not to act against the life of your neighbor. I am the Lord. You shall not hate your fellow countrymen in your heart. You may surely reprove your neighbor, but shall not incur sin because of him. You shall not take vengeance, nor bear any grudge against the sons of your people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord."
Okay, thank you, Ross. And then Van Christian, who is pastor of First Baptist Church Comanche. And Van, it is Matthew 25, 31 through 46. Your best preacher voice.
"When the Son of Man comes to his glory, and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at the left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, 'Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me.' Then the righteous will answer him, 'Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?" And the king will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me." Then he will say to those at his left hand, "You that are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not give me clothing. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me." Then they also will answer, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not take care of you?" Then he will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me." And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life.
Okay. Not the least of which, that gets me a little rest. But thank you, both of you. Now, what I'm trying to illustrate, what I suggested earlier, where you start, where you get. And, yeah, those of you who work with Scripture know I've loaded this up. It's going to come out right. But there's a little something for everybody there. Old Testament, New Testament, got a little fire here at judgment. Never hurts. Bring some of that in. Okay. But there are the passages that I'd like for you to think with me about more specifically. All I've said so far actually does have something to do with the Bible and hunger. Now, Long had three options. Augustine had four. I've got five. These aren't lockstep kinds of things. Now, if you want to put them forward like that, they're pretty easy to teach. But the way real people live with these things, and that's how I picked them up, just watching how people interpret and live out Scripture, they don't necessarily move along in this lockstep, master one approach, and we're on to the next, we'll get that. They do build on each other, and sometimes they depend on all parts being in any particular one. But I will lay these out in a kind of sequence. It would be much better, let's see, where's Dr. Hall now? In the new facility, do we have holograph possibilities? We could just do multi-dimensional presentations here, and then you could get this. Here are the components. The guideline thoughts. The Bible and hunger. These two passages. Thou shalt not. Thou shalt. I must. I will. I am. Simple enough. Thou shalt not. You heard that from Long, particularly earlier. This thou shalt not approach, that's what ethicists call the deontological approach. Obligatory, the imperatives, the commands from Scripture. And I know people who have lived their entire Christian life living out of understanding the Bible as thou shalt not. And for the most part, they've had a quite good life. So, there are some things about it that we've got to understand. But with Leviticus, for instance, and it's 19:9 where this appears, here's the thou shalt not. You shall not reap to the very edges of your field. You shall not strip your vineyard bare. There are things that develop out of that. From Matthew, the thou shalt not is more by implication. But it doesn't take very many readings of it to see that certainly, as Jesus said, just as you did not do it to one of the least, you did not do it to me. Sort of from the flip side. The idea communicated, it is a thou shalt not. Do not do these negative things. Then thou shalt. From Leviticus, the writer projected imperatives to perform, gather the gleanings of your harvest, leave them for the poor and the alien. Now, if you've been around Hebrew study at all, you understand that the Hebrews had an interesting way of saying negatives and positives. They knew that whenever a thou shalt not came at them, they needed to step on the other side and look back, for the thou shalt was there. Two sides of the same coin. Thus, the thou shalt not in this Leviticus 19:9 and thou shalt, they're in the same verse. Don't do this, but do this. From Matthew, on the thou shalt. Still somewhat of an implication, but certainly an example. An example indicative of what the positive thing is to be. And that's when Jesus said, look, when you fed, you gave drink, and welcomed the stranger. You did those things to me. And there's the positive corrective. Do these things to me as if I am literally in front of you. With this Matthew passage, and if you know anything about Matthew, quite probably he put his gospel together primarily for a Jewish readership. And there are all sorts of things through it that demonstrate how he used words and phrases. He was trying to get the gospel across to his Jewish friends, family, culture. And in fact, it comes out here in the Matthew passage about not doing this, you did not do this. There are actually double negatives that come. And just like in math, two negatives, you can get a positive. So the flip side is coming through from Matthew. I said the third form, I must. Now this is still a deontological approach. Duty. It's a directive, an imperative. This particular version of the NS, or New Revised Standard that you read from, Van, some of the red letters. Here are commands from Jesus. But notice how the subject changes in this mode I'm presenting to you. Thou shalt not, thou shalt, I must. Hear it? It has moved from an external directive that now I, the decision maker, the implementer of the gospel thing, I have heard the directive from God. I've got a choice about it. But there is also the expectation of response that's hanging there. I must. And if you want audience participation, fill in your name. Because it's there. Absorbing scripture for myself and living out that command. It understands that there is an engagement here, that life is not to be passively observed, but that these things in the master narrative, we have participation. In this case, these are those folks that they have a self-imposed dutifulness about them. I must. It's quite possible that they live that out and maybe their whole lives out of the formula O-D-T-A-A, one darn thing after another. There is reason why we call it church work. I must. It looks like, though, that with Scripture and with both these passages, Leviticus and Matthew, the I must dynamic recognizes the explicit directives, but begins to move in a transformational direction that I must love. It engages another value level, another level of motivation. And with a sense then of what is here, I must enact, even if I'm the only one that has heard this. That's how close in this charge comes. Well, then the fourth one, I will. With the I will mode of interpretation and application, one reads Scripture and hears it from perhaps a newly found internal motivational level. The external, the internal, duty-bound imperatives have been absorbed, maybe transformed, so that the application of Scripture becomes intentional, willful. It begins to be projected out there. The thoughts will come, if I'm here and now with these matters facing me, what can I do? What will I do to move these matters? Whatever I do, how will that affect out there? Next week, next year, 5 years. This has a much more future-oriented kind of expression. It looks like with the I will, reading of Scripture and engaging hunger, that there comes in a kind of freedom for the Bible reader and applier. And there's not so much now the shape of having to make a decision. And that energy begins to be turned, allowing one's imagination to work toward the future. And here I have to add, imagination has taken a lot of hits over the years. Read the Bible with imagination? Well, yeah. If you do a little word study, you'll find that the wellsprings of faith and imagination come together in Scripture. The God-formed imagination, willfully projecting what might be done. And with that, it looks like with the I will, because there's something of freedom coming in, the individual begins to project and see, you know, this is bigger than I imagined. There is more here. The first response may be, let's go back to the thou shalt not. That was a little easier to employ. But positively, it may begin to move in the matters of, I'm going to have some help. And that's exactly where Scripture moves. The several I wills began to work together. For apparently, they are discovering together the I will of God. And so, there are strategies, there are tactics, matters that are employed so that more are involved because the matters are so huge to be addressed. Well, then finally, I am. The Leviticus passage and the Matthew passage. One of the things that is parallel with both of those is comparison is made between those who are of God, followers of God, those who go by the name child of God, imitators of God, those who reflect the nature, person, and character of God. Those kind contrasted with those who are not of God. They do not follow God. They profane the name of God. They profane the name child of God. They do not imitate God, they do not reflect the nature, person, and character of God. Now, the Leviticus passage is at the core of what is known as the holiness code of the Old Testament. What opens up that Ross first read, the distinction is made right off. I am God, God said. And if you're going to go by my name, you need to do these things. You do these things in the spirit, the character that I do, you are worthy of being called of God. Is it pressing it too much? Another I am. You're becoming a whole being. Integrity is coming in. And one of those acts of integrity, he read the verses. One of those acts is to make sure people have food. With Matthew, it's an interesting culmination of other points. I have no idea specifically who heard that narrative that Jesus gave that Matthew put down. There most certainly were people there hearing that who had heard the other discourses, though. They had been up close. They had heard the with me and against me. They had heard the characterizations of those who love God. And interestingly enough, quite probably most of those disciples that followed Jesus closely had heard that, and they had also sat in on all of those dining experiences with Jesus. Have you ever followed that out? A whole array of character conversations around food. Ethical lessons. Food and ethics. And there it comes again. Most of them that were getting it said, yep, that's right. He said that before.